Actually, originally we were gonna do a pizza party.
Good afternoon, everyone. Oh, hey, thanks for coming on time. I'll get started soon. In just like a few seconds time, I just want to broadcast this so that in case you want to rewatch this or some of you guys who cannot really join us here live, you can watch this on the broadcast. Okay, let me just share screen for the Facebook. Testing. Okay, great. Going live now. Okay, again, once again, good afternoon. So this is a very short lunchtime session sharing. I hope that you all have taken care of your own lunch. Although it's lunch is short, but lunch is not provided. So any of you guys hungry or not? Hey, by the way, we made this interactive. So can you turn to the friend beside you and say, I'm hungry. Hungry for knowledge, okay? So are you hungry for knowledge? Yes? Hey, come, join us. So, okay, today, right, I'm going to talk about ETF investing. Okay, ETF stands for Exchange Traded Fund, and I want to share with you a very simple 4-step idea of how to invest in ETF, and also I will be going through some particular websites that I also use, okay? Now, what is ETF about, right? I want to use an illustration or analogy. Any of you guys here are single? You know what a single mean, right? Single means you are not married or not attached. Any of you single? One person only, ah? Okay, the rest of you all single and attached, is it? Okay, so this is not a matchmaking session. I just want to use this as an analogy. Okay, so for those who are single, it will be quite a lousy analogy, lah, now that I think about it. ETF, right? You know, investing is like you want to choose a good stock, it's like you want to choose a good partner, right? Sometimes you buy a bad one, you buy a bad stock, you're full of regrets. So, how many of you attached and you feel a bit like your life could be, never mind, we talk about this other time, okay? So basically, you see, that's why, you know, I was watching those Chinese dating show. That's all, wow, it's very stressful. They have to choose the correct date, you know? Then out of maybe 24 contestants, they must choose the best of the best one. So ETF investing is this. ETF investing is right. Sometimes you're worried that you buy a stock and you buy a wrong one. So how to avoid this altogether? Actually, for all investors, the key thing is to reduce risk. And one way to do it is by having a portfolio. So let's say portfolio. Everybody say portfolio together. 1, 2, 3.
Portfolio.
My question is this, how many stocks should there be in our portfolio? 10 to 15, 15 to 20. Anything more than 3 or 4 or 5, right? It's only one is not called a portfolio. So actually the dating idea is a bad idea. You cannot have a portfolio of dates. Okay, I mean maybe you can. You say, okay, I don't know who to date. We have a group date, then we find the best of the best. Okay, let me ask you this. What is the advantage of having an ETF portfolio? Now, ETF is called Exchange Traded Fund. What it means is, when you invest into any ETF, which I will illustrate in a moment's time, basically you are buying a ready-made portfolio. Okay, ready-made. And it can be team-based. So what are the advantages? Number one, diversified risk. Okay, just think about it this way. Okay, so for example, like I mentioned you want to choose the perfect date, right? So what are some criteria that you look for when you look for a partner? Come on, give me one. Kind, okay, kind-hearted, right. So ETF, very interesting. You can, let's say one person date 20 girls, which I advise you not to, but just using this as an example, out of 20, high chance there's at least one kind person, right? So the cool thing about having an ETF or a portfolio of stocks is, you don't need all of them to be kind. Okay. In the real world when you're dating, yes. But in the stocks, you don't need all of them to be successful. You just need one or two good winners. Just think about it this way, huh? Maybe 10 or 20 years ago, or maybe 15 years ago, you're not sure which technology stocks is good. You buy Microsoft, you buy some other business that in the end didn't make it. You just need one or two of them to become the next Microsoft or Alibaba or Facebook. That's when you become very wealthy already. So this is the cool thing. You don't need to be perfect in choosing stocks when you have a portfolio. Understand this, huh? Now, the cool thing is, right, you can identify based on broad-based criteria. Okay, so what does it mean? Unlike stocks, right, when you have to pick individual stocks, you say that you want to have specific criteria, they have low debt, they have very good earnings. All this you must do individual homework, which I still encourage you do that. But for, especially if you are a beginning investor, you are not very sure how to look at stocks individually, or you are still not confident, you just look at broad-based criteria. So for example, for him, he like kind dates. So he go and look for people who are kind. Okay, this one a bit quite specific. Or maybe he likes sporty ladies. Do you like sporty ladies? You don't like sporty ladies. Then what kind of ladies do you like? Average ladies. Are you married? You better let your wife hear this talk. So, okay, maybe they like ladies who like to invest. You like investor ladies. So when you buy an ETF, it is like based on category. Like I want to date this group of girls. From your frown, I see it's a very, very bad example. But basically, ETF, you don't need to like say, I want to buy specifically this company. You can go for categories. Can you give me some examples of categories or sectors that you all think is going to be better in the next 3 to 5 years? What kind of categories? You all feel like, wow, there's a lot of potential one. Or any sectors or industries. Can you give me one example? Any example? Big data company, right? Maybe technology, you're still sure that you can't tell me that technology is going to go down. It's going to be better. But I do not know which particular specific technology company to invest in. I can invest in a technology ETF, which I'll show you in a moment's time, okay? Or maybe let me ask you, which region or which country do you all believe will be a very strong powerhouse in the future? China? Anywhere else? Or which?
Brazil?
Okay, for some reason, Brazil. Why Brazil? Okay, this is the first time I heard of it. Brazil is going to be the next powerhouse. It's okay. You know what's the coolest thing, man? She can invest into Brazil, you can invest into China, okay? And you know, because you're investing in ETF, for example, she said that I believe Brazil is going to be the next big thing. But there's also a possibility you are wrong, right? So instead of investing in individual Brazil companies, you can invest in the whole Brazil economy and it will become one ETF in your whole portfolio. Meaning to say, you can just say, I just want to invest 5% into Brazil because I believe in them. And you can invest another 10 or 20 ETF or stocks that you believe in, okay? So it can be very broad-based. Now the disadvantage is you cannot cherry pick, okay? Meaning to say, although you like Brazil, but maybe some particular companies you don't like in the ETF, you cannot take them out of the ETF, okay? Because when you're buying a ready-made portfolio. And lastly, you have to pay some fees, which I want to talk about as well. Because ETF, by nature, is a ready-made portfolio. Someone is doing the work for you, you have to pay certain fees. But how much is too much, and what is a reasonable amount? I'll give you some benchmark today, okay? So the whole idea is, today, when you walk out of this place, or when you go and watch the replay of this video, you have this particular website where you know how to screen for ETF, and I think it's a very good way to get started. Any of you guys are very new to ETF or very new to investing? Very, very new. Okay, congratulations. You're surrounded by experts. The rest of them feel that, wow, I'm here is because no other place got aircon room and got seats. Okay, so it's okay. Bring your lunch over, we'll chit chat. Okay, so four steps to ETF investing. So four things. The first one is fundamentals. Everyone say fundamentals. Actually, the cool thing about ETF is this. The fundamentals is only based on a few things. And the key thing is confidence. Just your particular confidence in a certain sector or certain country. That's about it. Of course, where does the confidence come from? For example, she said Brazil. She must have you must have some reason why you said Brazil, right? What was the reason? Okay, so she mentioned she has been reading some news about Brazil and the stock market is rising very quickly. Again, when we look at ETF, when we look at sector, we must believe in the fundamentals of it. Some of you say China. You all believe China will be much bigger 5 years later? Okay, this is based on your certain data point, like you have been reading certain things. All this information help us have a better direction of where this confidence comes from. Like big data, or later I'll tell you certain other sectors that I personally feel that it's going to become much bigger. And sometimes it's based on discretionary. Discretionary means to say, right, when you say that you believe something is going to become bigger, it's actually a theory. There's no way you can exactly prove it. You can look at past growth rate. You can say, well, this particular sector is growing at this rate and there's certain potential. The industry is this size. Okay, you can use certain data, but the future is always discretionary. Meaning to say you're just guessing, right? But the guess must be logical, right? So I read the news about also some data point about Nigeria. You know what's the key thing about Nigeria that makes me interested? The population growth rate is very fast. Okay, in fact, y'all know where's the biggest population growth rate? Which country? Or population growth, which one has the fastest? Meaning you say every single day their IC number or their ID number have to increase by a lot of numbers because a lot of babies are being born. Which is the country with the most babies born per second? Sounds like, wow, baby come out, come on. Which country, huh? Indonesia? India? China, right? Indonesia, okay, I've not checked that. So it's India and China. Every second, wow, a lot of babies are born. The third one is actually Nigeria, based on what I read. So I said, hey, it's very interesting. Because in every economy, every country, population is very important for the economic growth. Why? Because with more population, more people, it means there's more customers. Imagine I'm selling chicken rice. Okay, if let's say there's like 10 million people in my country, there's 10 million addressable market. But when there's 100 million, there's even more. Okay, so the first thing is fundamentals. Okay, then let me show you. We have talked about some places, some countries, some sectors. Let me show this website called ETF.com. Wow, this is a very, what do you call that, creative URL, right? This URL is called ETF.com. Make a guess, what do they do? Yeah, they talk about ETF now. Okay, I'm just trying to crack some lame jokes, but doesn't matter. Let's take a look at this. How do we go to this place? Type ETF.com, that's all. Okay, now let me show the cool thing about this. A lot of people go to this website, they may not know what to do and where to really start hunting for ETF. Once you are here, again, this whole screen is recorded, so you can go back and watch on the Facebook page, okay? This is the place, ETF, tools, and data. So basically, this portion, I typically only use these two things. One is the ETF screener and database. The other one is the ETF stock finder. Okay, this is quite interesting. Later I show you the stock finder, how do we use. But now let me show you ETF screener and database. Okay, let's see what are some interesting ETF. You can see that we can actually screen ETF by a few things. So for us, we are looking at the fundamentals first, right? Like what kind of fundamentals are we looking at and how do we actually find things. So example, geographical location, you can say, okay, I believe in Brazil. You can click Brazil. Now, when you click Brazil, you will see there's 9 ETFs. You see that? So there's 9 ETFs for you to choose from. And there you have it. You can invest in this ETF in Brazil. Okay? So any other geographical location you all believe in? Asia Pacific. Do you think Asia Pacific will be growing for the next few years? Okay, you can see, interestingly, a lot of the ETF, there's Asia Pacific, and Asia Pacific exclude Japan. So a lot of fund managers, they are excluding Japan because Japan is a very old country. Okay, it's not an old country in a sense, but the population growth is very slow, and there's also this thing called deflation. It's very interesting, you know. The whole entire world has inflation, and for Japan, you all know the interest rate in banks, how much is it? It's negative interest rate. You put money in the bank, must pay them. Now you put money in your bank, they pay you interest, right? You put money in Japanese bank, you must pay them to help you keep your money. This is that's why a lot of people have very low confidence in. Well, Japan doesn't seem like a very good place to invest in. Personally, maybe another topic I'll tell you about Japan. I've been to Japan, I feel that a lot of fund managers, they are not seeing a lot of things in Japan. Okay, because Japan, one of their main customers is not just domestic, you know, they are very strong at exporting a lot of things. Okay, so a lot of things that they are using is also produced in Japan. Okay, but let's look at this. Coming back to here, maybe you are interested in Africa, you can choose. You'll see there's only one ETF. Okay, so this is the whole key thing. You go for the fundamentals. Now, you can also go for categories. Okay, maybe let's look at some of the segments. Okay, let me go for broader categories first. Focus. Okay, so there are quite a few things. You can look at maybe crude oil, gasoline, global, macro. Well, there's quite a lot of things. Okay, so if you believe like certain things like utilities is going to become stronger, or telecommunications, do you think telecommunications will be a good sector to invest in? Yeah, maybe you say, oh, telecommunications, I probably want to invest in telecommunications. You can see, wow, there you have it. There is 15 ETFs for you to choose from. Okay, so this is the first part, fundamentals. Okay, so using this, you can find ETF with different fundamentals. I know there's a lot of other functions like feed, efficiency. All these, if I have time, I'll talk about it. I want to focus on four key important things. Now let's see the whole thing first. Okay, if let's say we do not choose any of these, you can see there's like 2,000 over ETFs based on this database. Okay, and I think every other few months there's another ETF coming up based on themes. So, okay, another way to do it is we straight away go and search for ETFs using Google. So, for example, I was talking to a friend and he told me that driverless cars. Do you think driverless car will be a potential? You think so? Okay, maybe some of you yes, some of you no. Doesn't matter. It's discretionary. There's no right or wrong. So, for example, driverless car, you can type ETF behind. Usually, they will bring you to this thing called ETF database. Let's see whether there is. Okay. ETFDB, okay, ETF database. Okay, this one they drop base it into artificial intelligence. Maybe driverless ETF is only a few. Okay, so you can see they have 44 artificial intelligence ETF, and you can go in there and take a look at the database. Okay, so let me show you how it looks like. These are the two websites that we typically use: ETFDB database, where they show you all the different types of ETFs. From the names, right, you can roughly guess what they are doing now. Because the ETF usually, they will make their names very explicit. So example, most of you can see. You screen down and then you see whether there's any driverless cars. Okay, you can see this one, right? Electric car ETF. Electric car ETF, and their ticker symbol is ERIV. Very, very interesting. It's true. A lot of times, they're going to make it very obvious to you that they are from like driverless car or things like that. Okay? So this is fundamentals. This is only the first portion, fundamentals. Let me show you the next thing you should look at, okay? In any investing, you want to buy good investments. So, in this case, for ETF, when we say good, is we believe that this sector or this country can become more powerful next time. Okay? So, later give me some more ideas, we can search for it. Do you have any other ideas in the meantime? Those on the Facebook, you can also type some other ideas you have. What other sectors? Just like you talk about big data, right? Let's search for big data also. So same thing, you can just search for big data ETF. Oh, they also go to like artificial intelligence, you realize that? Okay, but the ticker symbol, okay, AIQ, but only got one. Okay, interesting, let me show this, how to further analyze this, or how to further find other comparable ETFs. For example, AIQ, what I'll do is, again, it's just these two websites, okay? But a lot of times, you realize I focus a lot on Google. I will type AIQ plus ETF.com behind. What happens is, they will bring me to the specifics of this AIQ, where I can dig in further into the fundamentals, okay? Now, for example, this AIQ, what do I look at? I look at this portion. They will give you a description. So AIQ, description. So they track developed market equities involved in artificial intelligence and big data. So you believe that big data is going to be the next big thing, but you're not very sure exactly which company to invest in. You invest in this ETF, you are getting your money into this sector. Okay? Now, there's more right now, but let me show you. You scroll further down, you want to look at the top 10 holdings. Okay, so these top 10 holdings, they are involved in big data. They may not be developing big data, they may be the one using big data. So like Salesforce.com, Oracle, and so on, Amazon. So if you are interested in all these companies, but you're saying, wow, to buy all of them cost me a lot of money, you can just buy into one of these ETF, which is currently at $13.94. So if you have an account, any brokerage account, actually, you just key in AIQ, you can buy even one stock. So at least if big data becomes something big, you've got some money inside, but $13.49, even if you grow 10 times, you make 1,000% returns, then you will become $130. Okay, enough for you to buy a few burgers to eat. But the whole idea is you can use a small portion of money to invest into certain sectors that you like. Now, if you look at the screen, another place that can allow you to have more ideas is this competing ETF. You see that? Okay, but this one, right, they classify them under global technology. So competing ETF, or you can see a related ETF channel like artificial intelligence, broad base. Okay, so for example, you say I want to have more ETF that talks about artificial intelligence. Click on this, they will give you more ideas. So they have all these ETF that is talking about artificial intelligence, like robotics, robo, or the driverless car is here, okay, and so on. Oh, this is very interesting. BIKRI. You all see this Rogers AI Global Macro ETF? You know, from the name, you can guess a lot of things. Anybody knows what is this ETF about? Anybody heard of this ETF before? BIKR? This is very interesting. It's by Jim Rogers. So they work together with Jim Rogers, who is one of the very strong fund managers, and they pick his brains, take his criteria, put inside this artificial intelligence ETF, where they become a it's robotic. So they invest automatically using this algorithm. And it's called BIKR. What does BIKR sound like to you? Anybody can give me some suggestion? Huh? No, BIKR, but Berkshire is BRK, right? But what does BIKR sound like? Biker, right? Actually, it's biker. Do you know why it's called biker? Because Jim Rogers, he actually rode the bike around the world one time. So they call it a biker ETF. Quite interesting, okay? So these are the ideas. So again, step one, use your imagination. Everyone say imagination. Have or not? Do you have imagination? Have you like one day like worry that your boss scold you? You're imagining things, right? He'll scold you, he'll say bad things for you. So if you ever worry before, right, you have imagination. Channel this imagination to something useful, like an ETF, okay, can? So this is the first portion, fundamentals. The next portion, okay, first one is fundamentals, second one is undervalue. Everyone say undervalue. This is the interesting part. Okay, so ETF, we are buying broad-based, we are buying the whole entire basket of stocks. How do we assess whether it's undervalued or not? I'm going to give you a benchmark. The benchmark is the P ratio less than 12. Okay? P ratio less than 12. Do you all need me to explain what's P ratio? Okay, I will show you how to find P ratio first, and then I will explain slightly what it means. Okay? Now, this is the benchmark for ETF that are stable. Example, telecommunication. Example, certain countries that's quite big, but you want to invest in. But for ETF that has potential to grow, for example, driverless car, for example, big data, technology, or later I'll show you some like payment gateways, you have to use more PE lesser than G. It's called, it's a growth indicator, a growth valuation. But here comes the issue. The issue is the G means growth rate. The G, again, is discretionary, meaning to say you must assign a growth rate to this kind of sectors. For me, if the sector is something that is very high potential, like artificial intelligence, something that I don't even know whether they can make it, but if they make it, it's going to become very big, right? My assigned growth rate usually is about 25. So if it's a very fast-growing sector, I will say, okay, PE below 25, I'm willing to put some money inside that. But again, I won't put a lot. Roughly about 5%, 10% put into the particular ETF. Okay? And, so remember this. First one is fundamentals, second one is undervalued. Okay? Now, let's look at some how to check out whether they are undervalued or not. Am I going too fast? You all can stop me anytime, okay? Or you make it, huh? Okay, so well, everybody is looking at the ignoring right now. Okay, so what happens is, you can see back to this thing called ETF screener. Again, I'll go back to all the way back to ETF.com. So I run through the whole thing again. At any point in time, just ask me questions and also give me ideas. Okay, HACK. So there are a few ways to do it. One is to go through the screener to find undervalued ETF and then move backwards. Or like she give us an example, HACK. Okay, you like hack? Okay, she likes to hack things out. Okay, HACK. HACK is a cybersecurity ETF. So HACK, and then I'll choose ETF.com. Okay, can you see that? So you see, usually the first one, you will see hack ETF. I click into it. So remember, the first thing we look is fundamentals, and then after that, undervalue. So HACK, Prime Cyber Security ETF. Wow, guys, let me ask you, do you think cybersecurity is going to be a big thing?
Yes.
Is it going to become bigger?
Yes.
So if you all make money, you all must go and thank her, okay? If you all lose money, also go and thank her, okay? So now, the price now is $35.66. Okay, this one is just to highlight this. But again, go through the four-step checklist. First one is fundamental. Let's take a look at what they do. So you can see, this is where they segmentize it, global technology. Okay, you can click on cybersecurity. See whether there are any other ETFs that talks about cybersecurity. Currently, two ETF, HACK and CIBR. Okay, let's go back to HACK first. Okay, so what can you do? You can go and take a look again, fundamentals of hack. You can see what is the top 10 holdings. Splunk. Is it Splunk? You pronounce that Splunk? Splunk, Cisco, and a lot of all these companies that frankly I got never seen all this before. But because I believe in cybersecurity, that's a good thing, you know. That's a good thing about India. I don't know about these companies. And personally, if you ask me to go and dissect and go and study all these companies, I will come up with nothing because I don't understand enough. But I have a certain belief that say hey, cybersecurity is going to be the next big thing. So therefore, this ETF again, I just need one or two of them to do very well. My whole entire ETF will do well. Okay, that's the whole idea. Okay, you can go and click all and then see what's happening. Oh, I heard of this company called Checkpoint. When I was in reservist, one of my friend works in this company and he told me how good it is and how slave driver the company is, making him do a lot of work. So I said, wow, very good, very good. I want to be a shareholder also. So, but when I checked, the price went up a lot. It's a pretty interesting company. I'm joking about the slave driver thing. Okay. So, okay, now. So where do I check whether it's undervalued or not? Let me show you. You scroll down. Okay, typically if you open it on your browser, it may not look like this. Because I'm screening it on the projector, that's why it looks like this. Okay. Once you go to hack, you scroll down, can you see this portion, PE ratio? Wow, the PE ratio is 86.23. Let me explain what this means. It means that Sartori's parables, okay, I'm trying to show some chim words. Okay, what it means is, if things are equal, if this ETF continue to make money that the way they are making every single year, it takes you 86 years to break even. It will take you 86 years to make back your money. Let me ask you this, is this considered cheap or expensive? Expensive, because you won't want to invest in something that takes you 86 years to break even, right? So that's why our benchmark was below 12, okay? But however, for me, I think that cybersecurity is a very fast-growing sector. So I'm willing to buy them when the PE ratio is maybe less than 25, okay, 25 or below. So currently, what do you do about this? You can hack this, okay? Just put it one side. And seriously, it's really too expensive. So fundamentals, good sectors, and second one, undervalued. This one, confirm not undervalued. Oh, you still got a chance, right? This one, CIBR. Let's see whether this one got another better entry point for us. Okay, CIBR, same thing here. Well, the P ratio also, not on one, 54. So, a bit hard to buy. Okay, in my opinion, I will not invest in this ETF. I'm interested in cybersecurity, but probably not now. Okay, so if you have an idea, type in the ETF.com and then see the PE ratio. Now, if you have not much idea, okay, where shall I start? You go to ETF.com, you click on screener and database, we close the rest. Okay, and you can start by finding cheap ETF, and then you go and see the fundamentals. So for example, ETF results 2000 over ETF, I'm going to click 100 per page, so there's 23 pages. What I'll do is, and you see this thing called fundamentals? Click on fundamentals, there's this thing called PE ratio. Now PE ratio, you click it one more time, they will help you arrange from the lowest to the highest. Wow. Okay, when they say it's minus PE, can you see minus PE? What it means is that ETF on the whole is losing money. So all the companies add up together, they are losing money this year. That's why it's a minus PE. Because PE is price to earnings, the price of the ETF versus how much they are making you. If they are making you negative, price will never really be negative. Because you are buying shares from the stock market. So again, we are looking for below 12, but we want a positive one. Okay, you can see PE of 5, let's take a look. Invesco China Real Estate ETF. Okay, TAO, Tao. So if you are nothing to do with religion. So basically, if you believe that China real estate is going to be the next big thing and the P ratio is only 5 point something, it can be a good time to invest in. Okay? By the way, you can see that on the left side here is dividend yield. So all these ETF, they also give you dividends. Do take note, if you are not investing from US, you are not a US investor, if you invest in ETF and they give you dividends, they will hold with 30% as withholding tax. So if they give you $1 as dividends, what will happen is, they announced $1 of dividends. You look at your brokerage account, it come only for 70 cents. Where did that 30 cents go to? Where? You are going to went to Donald Trump, okay? So all these dividends, it's not bad, it's still an indicator that you still get some cash. Okay, let's take a look at this. Turkey ETF. How many of you think that Turkey is going to be something that you believe in? Yes, you believe. Why?
Somewhere low.
Okay. That's why you must come earlier. You miss out the first portion. Fundamentals is you believe that this country's fundamental can become bigger and better next time. Okay, again, when you say low, maybe you mean something else. So Turkey, how about Russia? Russia, now you can enter at a P ratio of 5 point something. You can see that, right? So you can go through, okay, maybe Hong Kong. Can you see Hong Kong? 6 point something. Or Hong Kong maybe sounds a bit more familiar to me. I'm not saying Turkey or Russia is not good. It's just that I may not understand them so well. Okay? Now, in order for you to find out more, you can click through it and then see what they are holding. Can you see that? So let's take a look at some more. For me, okay, like I think some of you who have been watching what I've been doing like this pretty much. It's called FXI. The ticker symbol is FXI. It's China Large Cap ETF. So I pretty much believe that China will become a bigger economy in the future. And the P ratio is 8.48. Can you see that? Okay, so you can go through and see what are some of the ideas that you have. Okay? So this is where you find undervalue. So fundamentals and undervalue. Now, if you want to go for more like specific categories, again, you can check for them. Okay, then? Okay, so these are the two criteria. Now, there's two more criteria. Let me show you the next two. Okay, the next one is cost. Expense ratio. Now, even if you buy a good ETF with good fundamentals, you need to say you have confidence in the sector. Second one, if it's undervalued, okay, the P ratio is low. The next thing is cost. Okay, cost is expense ratio. What does this mean? It means that when you are buying ETF, you are buying someone, you are actually buying a company that's managing all these stocks for you, okay? So, expense ratio, can you see that? I want it to be less than 1%. So, if you pay less than 1% for a well-managed fund, it is pretty decent. This one is a well-managed, let's say, sector. Okay, then? Cool. Yes. Yes. Okay, P less than G. So P less than, okay, if it's P less than 12, if P is less than 12, actually to me it's a pretty good indicator that it's considered cheap. Then, now if P is more than 12, for example, let me show you this particular ETF, okay? Let's say, let me go iPay. See, I've been searching on this. iPay. So for example, I tell you about this ETF. Can you see what is this doing? Mobile payments, right? Okay, mobile payments. And you can read the description. So they track global equity in credit card firms, providing payment infrastructure. Okay, in my opinion, this is my opinion. I think e-commerce is going to continue to be good. And e-commerce, again, many websites are going to they're going to spawn out from nowhere, right? But anyway, whatever website that you use, you need to have a payment gateway. Make sense so far? So I think this is a very high potential one. Okay, so this one fundamentally I think is okay. The next portion I look at is the P ratio. 36.46. Now, by right, we are supposed to buy ETF with P ratio lesser than 12. But for this particular ETF, I'm willing to buy it when it is 25. Okay, so I mean for those, do you want me to help you complicate things a bit more? Is it okay?
Yes.
Okay, let me help you complicate things up because I know some of you guys, you like things to be interesting and exciting, okay? So how do I calculate the entry price for this? Because maybe some of you use options and things like that, right? So how do I complicate things? Now, we can do a reverse engineering. Currently the price, the P, okay, P is price over earnings. So the price is 38.37, right? How many remember this? Okay, let me see whether is there a calculator here. Okay, and the P ratio is 26.46. You can see this is the formula. Price divided by earnings equals to 26.46. So price was 38, right? So I want to calculate the earnings. How do I calculate the earnings? The earnings bring over, the price bring down, right? Okay, yeah. So it is 38.37 divided by 37 divided by 0.46. So the earnings is 1.545. Make sense so far? Okay, yeah. Okay, it doesn't make sense as matter. I'm just trying to impress you that I know the formula. Okay, then what you do is this: after you get the earnings, multiply by 25 because my P ratio highest is 25. So my entry price for this particular ETF is 36.25. If you don't know what I'm talking about, screw it, okay? What is important is you come back here, you check. Is the P ratio at 25? So you can check out, okay, 25 really hot, then you just go in. Okay, understand? Can that make sense? Okay, again, the growth is very subjective. I do not know how much these payment gateways will grow, alright? But in my assessment, my own personal benchmark, I don't know where I get this number from, okay? But actually based on my experience. Based on my experience, all these like unicorn companies, companies that have very high potential and have very interesting stories to tell, right? For me, maximum I go up to 25. Okay? Some of them you see like Alibaba, all those companies, right? Their P ratio can be up to 40 and stuff like that. And you can never have a chance to buy them. So some particular individual companies, sometimes lesser than 30 I'm willing to buy. Like personally, Facebook, I think that PE lesser than 30, I think it's something I can swallow because I believe they can grow bigger. Okay? Do you think Facebook can make more money next time?
Yes.
Yes? You think so? Yes. Okay, it's subjective, okay? But I think that they have the potential. Because a lot of times when we do business, we advertise on Facebook, okay? And that's where they can charge higher price. But let's say Apple, do you think Apple can grow more? Apple company? Some say yes, some say no, right? How many of you use Apple computer? The rest haven't used iPad, okay. How many of you don't use Apple stuff? Okay, I can grow a bit more now, okay? Can you see? Like the whole entire room, maybe another 10% more. So no much chance. Okay, we shouldn't do this kind of ballpark. Hey, but personally just a side track. I personally do that, you know. So like when I was in where was I? In Malaysia, I like to like when I'm standing in queue, for example, you're stuck in MRT, you're stuck in queue, just take a look around, I will count in what kind of shoes are people wearing, and you'll see a certain trend, okay? So maybe don't make it too obvious that you're staring, counting, people think you're weird, but just observe around, you can see what has potential. Again, I want to say it's discretionary, okay? So okay, coming back to here, understand so far? P less than 12, P less than growth, yes. Okay, so the question is, I have the experience, but you don't have the experience, so how do you get the growth, right? That's why you're here, that's why I give you the number. Okay, so you can tap onto my experience, and along the way, you form your own experience and come out with your own indicator. Okay, now, let me show you expense ratio. For example, this one, iPay. iPay, yes, it's iPay, right? Let me confirm. iPay, which is the mobile payment ETF. Now, this is where I see PE ratio, right? Where do I see expense ratio? Scroll a bit upward, you can see expense ratio 0.8, so not that bad. Okay, yeah, this one pass. So next time when the P ratio drop below 25, I will just collect a bit. Can also, but can Okay. So actually, pretty much this is the few things that I use. Where am I? Oh, I was at the screener, right? Now actually, the screener can show you quite a lot of things. You see, let me show you. For example, the P ratio is here. Is there a way to... Okay, the P ratio is here. So for example, Turkey and things like that, right? So this is the P ratio. Turkey, let's say I believe that they have good fundamentals based on what he said, okay? Then P ratio is 5.51. Okay, good. Then the next thing, how do I look at expense ratio? It should be here, fund basics. Can you see the expense ratio is also here? You can see most of the ETF, their expense typically won't be that high one. Oh, but you can see 1.06. It's slightly on the high side. Don't know what this does. Bull Bear Value 2000 ETF. Okay, so you can see all these above one, typically I don't like paying too much for ETF. Because the nature of ETF, they don't do much, you know. They just buy the whole entire basket of stock and that's it. They don't really go and rebalance much and things like that. They don't do a lot. Okay? Unless you're an ETF fund manager and you think that I'm insulting you and you think otherwise, please come and tell me. I want to know what you're doing also. Okay, yep. Okay, market cap is not so important. You mean AUM, right? Okay, what does AUM mean? AUM means how much money they have collected from their investors to buy all these ETF, really. In my opinion, not so important. It doesn't affect your growth, is it? Because this ETF, their price will go up and down when the individual stocks inside goes up and down. Understand? Not so much of when more people want to buy this ETF, the price increase. It doesn't happen that way. Okay, there's very low correlation. Okay? Yeah, feel free to ask me any questions. Huh? 0.18, okay? Very low expense ratio. Also, it's too cheap and you feel a bit worried, is it? Okay. Well, you're all very hard to please. Expensive also complain, cheap also complain. Okay. So, okay, let me see. 0.18. Let me check out SPER or SPY. Oh, give me specific examples to be better. Okay, so she has a particular ETF, you can look at it together. It's the best if you have specific examples. Can you see this one? 0.09. Something wrong. Okay, wait. This one, by the way, the person who created this one, he wasn't the one who created. But the person who initially accepted the idea is called John Boger, and he recently just passed away. So later we have 1 minute of silence. But anyway, for this one, SPDR, they buy into S&P 500 stocks, which is the 500 biggest stocks in the US. And because literally they do nothing, they just see, okay, now the index is actually by the stock exchange. So Singapore, we have this thing called STI 30. Right, 30 stocks. So there's STI ETF also. When you buy the ETF, the fund manager don't do anything. They just copy exactly what the stock exchange claims to be the 30th, like most representative stocks, and that's it. You know? So that's why the expense ratio is very low. Okay, but you don't feel sorry for them. Okay, you know why? This one, the expense ratio is 0.09, right? Let me see whether the AUM is 244.37 billion. Okay, so how much is it? Well, 1% is how much? 1% is 2 billion already. Right? So basically this fund is having 200 billion of funds in their account. So 1% is 2 billion. 0.1% is 200 billion. 0.01% is 20 million. So every year, their passive income is 20 million into their bank account. You know what's happening? Well, you want to be fund manager, right? Okay, so, this expense ratio multiplied by this asset under management is how much this particular ETF, the fund manager, is earning every year passively. It's really passive, okay? Quite passive, okay? Anyway, not something that we need to be concerned about. For us, we just need to focus on the fundamentals. F, fundamentals, U, undervalue, and then third one, the cost. Keep it very simple. ETF is not meant to be complicated one. If you really need to go and dive in, to go and dig in all this, you might as well buy individual stocks. Because likely they will give us better yield also. Okay? So, you got a particular stock? She got a particular ETF for us. Insurance, KIE. Okay, KIE. How do you pronounce it, KIE? Okay, KIE. You turn to your partner and the friend beside you and try to pronounce KIE. PIE is Thai, right? KIE is kind, whatever lah. Okay. So, again, pronunciation not important. Important is once your friend give you a possible idea. Okay, look at the fundamentals. Okay, insurance, US insurance. So, they track. Okay, you see. Let me explain to you the sentence. KIE tracks an equal weighted index of insurance company. Basically, what they mean is they just buy insurance company and their stocks are. So they will write a bit more in the index. There's an index sector. So like for example, they will say, oh, this whole sector went up by how many points, down by how many points. Same thing. The particular exchange, in this case, will be New York Stock Exchange. They will have a few stocks that represent the insurance industry. Okay, then? So fundamentally, who thinks that insurance in US will be something that's profitable? Okay? If you don't think so, of course, skip this whole entire ETF. If you think so, you say, okay, not bad, I want a foot in the insurance space. The next portion is, you can go and look at the P/E ratio, 12.92. So you must wait a bit more. But if you think that it's okay, you think that they will grow, you can actually buy it. Okay? And the next thing is expense ratio, 0.35. So far, so good. Okay, cool. Pretty interesting way to, easy way to invest. Recently, you find, hey, how come most of the ETF, the P ratio quite low, can buy, is because recently the stock market was going down. It went up quite a bit, by the way. So now it's actually, in my opinion, you can scoop out some of them. Okay? Can I? Okay, because some of you escaped from office for lunch, I'll just go straight to the last one. Okay, so first one, fundamental, second one, undervalued, third one, cost. The last one, very simple one. Okay, keep it simple. Everyone say, keep it simple. Okay, so what do I mean keep it simple? No leverage and no inverse ETF. Okay, so remember, I'll keep it very, very simple. Let me explain to you what is no leverage and no inverse ETF. Let me show you this. You go to the ETF screener. I just want you to avoid all this. Can you see, include here, there will be inverse and leverage. Again, this is the whole entire screener. Make sure you don't buy inverse or leverage ETF. Okay, let me show you. If I just look at all the inverse and leverage ETF, there's... Did I choose that? Okay, include, right, apply. How many ETFs are there? 12 ETF. Okay, what does it mean? Can you see this is, example, iPath US Treasury 10-year bear ETF. To make it simple for you, this is an inverse ETF. Why? Because they look bear. It is very funny one. Some people they try to be very creative. They say that okay, if S&P 500 goes up, or let's say the Treasury bears goes up, I want to have an inverse ETF. Means that if it goes up, I lose money. If it goes down, then I make money. So it's like a shocking ETF. So sometimes let me see any other things. There'll be very funny kind of ETF. You see, short means right. They actually short a group of stocks. So in this particular case, if you buy reverse ETF, you are hoping that particular sector goes down, then you make money. Understand right? The sector goes down, then you make money. So how many of you think that shorting is quite interesting? Anybody? Because last time when I attended some courses, right, the teacher got say, they say that stocks when they go up very slow, but drop down very fast. So you go for shorting one, it will be better. But along the way, I realize it's not the truth. Sometimes stocks can go up very fast also. Okay, so I feel like keep it simple. Don't make yourself confused. Don't go for those inverse ETF. So inverse means the stock price goes down, then you make money. So price goes down, ETF go up. Now, the next thing is leverage. What does leverage means? Let me see whether they got show some leverage ETF. Okay, leverage ETF. I think this one should be a leverage ETF. Enhanced, you can see. What does it mean? You can read into it. It will show you, it's called leverage ETF, okay? And what happened is, they actually like borrow money to invest. So they use margin or they use options to invest. So what it means is, if this whole group of stocks goes up by 10%, your ETF will go up by 30%. So they leverage, they move faster, okay? But if they go down by 10%, minus 10%, your ETF will, what happened? Go down by minus 20%, okay? So it's a double-edged sword. So keep things simple, okay? So what you have to do is, coming back to here, the ETF screener and database, actually pretty much I'm going to bring this to an end, then you can ask me any questions, okay? Now very simple, when you come to this entire screener, what you have to do is, first, click this exclude, okay? Keep it simple, exclude all this. Okay, after you exclude all this, you can go into specific niches if you want. Okay, maybe we look at this, any of your thing which industry can be solid one, can make money on. They based on teams. There's a lot. Okay, example. Toys and games. Okay, transportation. Transportation, you can go and see whether there is like, there's only five. Okay, transportation ETF don't look very interesting. Let's take a look at renewable energy. Yeah, renewable energy. Okay, this is something that I never really understand, but let's say, okay, I'm interested in renewable energy because I think that they may be the next big thing, right? And I also want to do my part for the world. So when I invest in this, I can tell my children that I'm a good person. Okay, so let's say you put your money into ETF. First thing, all these are renewable energy. So F, fundamental. Second one is undervalued, right? Undervalued, click on this. We can see, the P ratio, exciting, yeah. Okay, so look at the P ratio. Which one? Okay, to make it simple, we just click on this. It will sort out for you. Which one looks interesting to you?
Only one,
right?
Global X.
Okay, so which is this one. So once you can screen through, you can say, okay, this one may be the most logical one for me to invest in. But of course, why is this ETF has a positive P ratio while the rest are negative and things like that? Because their composition, meaning you say the stocks they hold is different. But makes sense, right? If you want to invest in something that is making money, and let's say the P ratio is logical, right? So you can go and do, a shortcut is here. You say, I want to go for renewable, I don't really know what they are holding, but I believe in this idea behind it. The P ratio is below 25, I think it's okay, quite near 12 or so. Then, F, fundamental, U, undervalued, next one is what?
Cost.
the cost must be less than 1%. Okay, is it less than 1%? This one, right, global X, right? Y, L, 0. Less than 1%. Okay, so far fast. And then is it inverse? Okay, very, very important. Go and take a look. Did they write that it's inverse or is it, what do you call that? Inverse or leverage? It's not, right? We already excluded it. So steady already. Socially responsible ETF. Okay, then? So, okay, there we have it. Okay, then? So I just summarize this whole thing. And then after that, y'all can ask me any question. So y'all remember the four criteria? Yes. What's the first one? Fundamental. So I have an acronym. It's a four letter word, starts with F1, then y'all can remember one. Okay. F is fundamentals, right? So U is what? U is undervalued, P ratio. Then the next one is what? Cost. The cost expense ratio must be below one. And the last one is? And no leverage. So F-U-C-N is like function now, okay? Function, but spell wrongly, okay? So no leverage, no inverse. So these four criteria, okay then? Simple, right? Next time you see ETF, just go through these four. Okay? So there's pretty much, did you all learn something? Cool?
Yeah.
You know? So okay, how do you get this video? Because, okay, I'm speaking a bit fast because some of you may need to go back to work. Okay, you can just go back to here, Sean. Or you can go to my YouTube. You can, okay, see any questions there. That connection, then you must change your internet, okay. So, I don't know what to say, okay. Y'all got any questions, y'all can ask for those on Facebook. Otherwise, y'all come back to Sean Xia, you can watch this video again, and then y'all can go through the resources. I'll put in more links here and there, okay. Now, any questions so far? If not, I will just end off this live video, then y'all can ask me any question. Okay, bye-bye.
There's a percentage of...
Yes. You mean the ETF, is it?
Yes.
Okay. So, where do you see that?
No, I mean, personally, in our work, how much ETF
should be? Oh, yeah. Can you help me off the YouTube also? Thank you very much. Okay. So, okay, percentage of portfolio. Okay, now, if you want to talk about portfolio, right, there are different ways to look at it. But basically, you treat ETF like a stock. Although inside the ETF, there's a lot of stock. It's like, super kiasu, you know. Your portfolio is to diversify risk.